Hi, it's Cate Crowley at Teachers College, Columbia University in New York City. Welcome to Cleft Palate Speech and Feeding Video Tutorials. We're now going into Module 1.3, where we look at submucous clefts and occult clefts. So what is a submucous cleft? Well, it's something, the reason you might look for a submucous cleft is you hear the child seems hypernasal, and some of the speech sounds seem to be consistent with cleft palate, but you've looked in their mouth, there's no cleft, and you've made sure there's no history of cleft, but you still hear these sounds, the speech sounds, and you hear hypernasality. Then you might say, I really want to look very carefully for submucous cleft. The three characteristics of the submucous cleft are a bifid uvula, something called a zona pellucida, and a notch in the posterior border of the hard palate. I'll talk a little more about each of them. So the zona pellucida is the bluish area in the middle of the velum, in the soft palate. So we're gonna shine a light when we do our oral exam. Shine a light, and we should see a lot of pink. If we see blue, it may tell us that there's mucosa there, but not regular amount or typical amount of underlying muscle mass. The velum may appear to be an inverted V, especially during phonation. So one thing I do during the oral exam, I have the child say, besides stick out the tongue and say, ah, so I can see back there, I also have them say, ka, 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 ka. That keeps the tongue down, but it also lets me see if there's an inverted V going on. The inverted V is caused by an abnormal insertion of the veli palatini muscles, the levator veli palatini muscles. Remember, that's the main one that lifts the soft palate up and back to create velopharyngeal closure. So with phonation, because the levator veli palatini is not fully, has not connected well or created this typically thick muscle tissue and that moves, when you say ka 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 instead of the whole palate going up, it tense up, and that's what you're looking for. Here's a nice photo of the zona pellucida. You shine a nice bright light in there, and you can see a zone, a sort of a bluish zone. Here's what it looks like, submucous clefts with an inverted V. So you see normally with the submucous, when you say ah or ka, that soft palate would be smooth. But here you have an inverted V. Let me show it to you. There you can see how that inverted V looks, what it looks like. And I'm going to show you now some videos of how that inverted V might look during the oral exam.
All right. And bueno.
Another feature of submucous cleft is a bifid uvula. So we say a bifid uvula, which means a split uvula. It could be split down the middle with two pendulous structures, or it may seem like it's one structure, but with a line down the center. That line would be the fusion line that didn't quite fuse. Or it may just have a simple indentation at the posterior border, or it may be small and undeveloped and not have a lot of movement to it. So here you can see this drawing by Tina Young. The lips are all sealed from the incisive foramen forward. The palate is almost all sealed from the incisive foramen backwards, except that little bit at the tip of the uvula. So there's your bifid uvula. Here is two different ways of seeing it. One is a more pronounced submucous cleft with a bifid uvula. You might even call that a cleft of the soft palate. And the other one, you can just barely see a little seam at the uvula. Otra vez. Otra vez. Here's a picture of actually one of our students who has a bifid uvula, who has no other clinical indications of cleft palate. Here's another child who looks like a bifid uvula. This is a repaired cleft palate. And the reason we put that in there is so you can see that sometimes you'll look in someone's mouth and say, I think there's a submucous cleft. But in this case, it does look like a submucous cleft, but it actually is a repaired palate where the surgeon did not reattach the uvula. And some surgeons do that, so when someone looks in their mouths, they look, you know, as typical as possible. And other surgeons, it's not important for the surgery or for speech, they find, so they don't repair it. But that's what you can see. Just want to make sure you can distinguish that. Here's another nice picture of a different submucous cleft. That's a more similar to the one I was describing, where there's sort of a line down and just an indentation at the bottom. And the third stigmata or characteristic of submucous cleft is a notch in the posterior border of the hard palate. So the hard palate goes back, and then in a normal palate, you can often feel a slight projection of the posterior nasal spine back there. But if there's a notch, this may indicate a submucous cleft. And the way you examine for that, you put a glove on, you use your pinky, and you feel back there. You need to feel for a few palates to have an idea what you're looking for. But again, you'll get to know your friends and neighbors in a different way once you start looking at their palates. One thing I wanted to emphasize is simply because someone has one of the three characteristics of a submucous cleft does not mean that they have a clinical issue that needs to be addressed by a speech therapist. For example, the young man whose bifid uvula I showed you, the student, Marco Sastre, he didn't know until he was in ninth grade that he had a bifid uvula because his speech was fine, his resonance was fine, and there was some strep throat on a trip, and so they looked in his mouth and said, look at that. For me, I've been teaching this class for a long time, and I actually have the inverted V. So come on in and have a look at my mouth. The last thing we're going to talk about is an occult submucous cleft. An occult is something that's hidden. So sometimes you're going to see a child who seems hypernasal, has some of those nasal emissions, has things that seem like cleft palate speech, but you can't see any of the characteristics of submucous cleft and no clefting and no fistula. You still may want to think that there is possibly an occult submucous cleft, but the only way to see that is through a nasoendoscopy exam, where you put the camera with the on the tube with the light up through the nose to see if there's a clefting up. You look above to see if the clefting is in the nasal mucosa through that way. So that is the end of module 1.3. Now we will continue on with module 1.4, velopharyngeal closure, and we'll talk more about those nasoendoscopic exams and the nasopharyngoscopic exams. Again, if you're just coming, all these modules are available at leadersproject.org.